Hello and welcome. This is Success Connections, and I'm John Merlino. Today we have June Clougher and Jaime Cartagena with us. June's the director of the Jump Start Incubator in Reading, and Jaime is the owner of Cartagena Agency, a division of Farmers. June, what is the Jump Start Incubator?
Hi, John. It's nice to see you. So the Jump Start Incubator is a place for startup and early stage businesses to come to get access to office space, to get access to the other amenities of being in a professional office building, but also to get the support, education that they need to learn how to run their business.
Okay, so it's the first starts.
It's the beginning stages. So it's all the people that are looking to start a business. Maybe they've started it in the last year or two, and now they realize there's some things they need to learn.
Right.
They didn't know everything that they thought they needed to know.
I can definitely attest to that. Mm-hmm. You know, you start a business with the craft, or in my instance with the craft, and you don't really think about all the other, you know, almost minutia that goes along with running the business day to day.
Exactly.
So, do you look for certain kinds of businesses to cater with the Jumpstart, or are you kind of all inclusive?
We've geared ourselves towards service type businesses. We can do some craft type businesses because of the physical space. We don't do as much with manufacturing because we can't fit them into our space. But the program actually also has something called an offsite client. And in those cases, we're actually able to work with clients who may have a small manufacturing facility somewhere else, but they want the additional education. And so
they can come to you guys and like for consultation to
make
sure that, like, you know, what they're doing is right.
Exactly.
And how long is a duration with the Jumpstart Incubator?
So the program is designed to be a two-year program. There are situations where people feel that they've gotten what they need in a little bit less time than that, and sometimes it takes a little longer.
Okay. So it really just depends on the client.
It does.
Maybe the industry they're in.
And, it does.
Do you find that the people who sign up for the incubator, they're not working a secondary job, this is it? Or do you find that they're still?
Oh no, we have both situations.
Okay.
Currently, the incubator has 17 different companies that we are working with. And there are two or three where the people are still working full-time jobs and trying to establish these new businesses.
Which is hard, but you know,
it
sometimes they feel like they need the footing still, right?
Exactly.
That steady paycheck so that
exactly.
They still have the cash flow coming in.
Exactly.
And how many different businesses can you guys hold at the Jumpstart Incubator?
So we have 9 offices, but the offsite part of the program allows us to help more companies. And I think right now at the 17 number, we're getting close to what I think is the maximum at this point. You know, maybe one or two more. You also tend to have, you know, some people leaving, and so then there's room for more people to come in. So it's constantly flowing.
It's like an ebb and flow.
Mm-hmm.
And so out of the 17, basically half of them are off-site.
Right, exactly.
And then you can deal with the manufacturers and the different industries.
Exactly, yep.
And then, June, let's just talk a little bit about your background. So you're the director of the Jumpstart Incubator, but it probably took some steps to get there, right?
Yes. So most of my career actually has been in accounting. So I got my bachelor's degree right around the corner at Albright.
Oh, look at that.
So I'm in the neighborhood. I just fell into accounting, and I've always loved it, and so gradually became a controller and then a CFO, and I worked in a variety of industries so that my experience in the businesses are, you know, pretty extensive. But also, my husband and I actually started a business, and so I understand what it feels like when you're starting at zero and trying to go forward
your way
from
up.
There. Yeah.
So it's years in the professional experience, your own small business, and so
exactly
lots of accreditation.
Exactly.
And so you have an accounting background. Do you find that financials are something that some of your clients need the most help with?
All.
All.
I would say that that's probably the hardest thing for someone who's starting a business that doesn't have the type of background that I have to understand. And so what I try to do is to break it down in a way that they understand why it's important to keep track of the money. You know, that if you're starting a business, you care, you should care about the money and where it is and
Absolutely.
Where it's going. But also to understand how that helps you to make decisions in your business moving forward.
So it's almost like they just need help from the basis of organization, of understanding of keeping track of their payments in and out so that they can make further decisions based on what they have in hand, right? Because I think cash flows are really important when it comes to a small business.
Absolutely.
And
that sinks many companies, not having a good handle on that cash flow.
Because you can easily overinvest. And
oh,
next thing you know, you're sitting here with all this inventory and you don't really have a means to sell it, or it's taking too long to sell. And
and then you need cash to pay something else, and it's sitting in your inventory.
Exactly. And I think that's actually one of my biggest challenges, too. It's like you want to invest, you want to be buying things at all wholesale at the higher levels, but you have to invest more money then.
Right.
So it's like, what is the give and take?
Right, right. And the other thing, too, is it's very important. It's great. I know your business. You enjoy the creating part of it, but you need to sell it, too.
Right.
So it's understanding, you know, marketing and the skill set of selling and,
which
you
is
know,
hard.
Pricing
I think
and all
selling
of those
is,
things.
Like, the hardest part because you really have to be a salesman then. And, like, you want your craft to speak for itself, but at the same time, you need to be the person selling it, right? It's like the craft's not alone.
Right.
Now, Jaime, how long have you been a client of the incubator?
I started June 1st of this year.
Okay, and was your agency already established at that point?
My agency, I established it February 1st of this year.
Okay, so basically established it, then signed up relatively soon. And then tell us just a little bit about what you do with your business.
I sell insurance with farmers. We sell homeowners insurance, renters insurance, automobile insurance, specialty products, which would be your motorcycles, boat crafts, things of that nature. We also do life insurance, commercial business insurance. We offer that as well. And being an incubator has also given me an avenue where my colleagues that are there, other business owners as well, that we could approach them and actually help them with their business insurance needs as well. So
you're really positioned interestingly there, because you are able to help all the other companies because you probably have more insight into the insurance world than they do, so you can come in almost as a consultant.
Exactly.
Where are you located?
I'm located in the third floor of the incubator.
And third floor. Do you have any plans on where you're going to set up your actual location?
It's something that we have in the works. We're looking for another place, but we're not ready yet.
Okay.
Until we get to that point.
Absolutely.
What Jim was saying earlier, there's lots of things that we have to overcome, and one of the things was organizing ourselves. I have Lisa Lott that works with me, my agent, so she helps me balance out the things that we're doing together. But getting ourselves together financially, doing our books and everything else is a position that we need to get better at and help ourselves get to that next level where we're going.
One of the things that's interesting, too, about having them located in the incubator and downtown is that Jaime and Lisa are bilingual. So
perfect.
Obviously being in Reading is a benefit to them and to the people of the city.
Yeah. And it's only becoming more, like, you need it more and more. I know that our new administrative assistant, she speaks mm-hmm. Spanish. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So, and we're hiring on more people who are bilingual, just because as a consultant, you need to be able to speak mm-hmm. everybody's language.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
What kind of licensing did you have to get to become an agent?
Well, I had to go through the property casualty, which okay. was allowed me to, excuse me, write the homeowner's insurance, automobile insurance, things like that. To be a farmer's agent, you have to be insured as or licensed as a life insurance okay. agent as well in order to do that.
And did you have to take, like, classes, tests?
There are online courses that we were able to take okay. through, I don't remember the name of the company, but their courses are online. It's 24 hours that we had to do online. And then there's a state licensing test that you have to take.
And then you have to take
at the end, yes.
And how long did that process take you?
It actually took me 2 weeks to get my property casualty, and it took me another 2 weeks to get my life insurance license.
Okay. So it's not too long. Mm-hmm. But it was it very challenging? Like, were the examinations, did you find?
The tests themselves are very definition oriented.
Okay.
So they're very tedious. You have to really study. It's not something that you can just take the course and think you're going to pass mm-hmm. it without taking the time to really mm-hmm. study it. Mm-hmm. They're very difficult. And for a reason, it's the thing with insurance is that you're taking somebody's life into your hands and all their assets. And if you don't provide the proper insurance, it can be very detrimental to the person that's not insured mm-hmm. properly, mm-hmm. you know, for mm-hmm. in case something were to happen, mm-hmm. you know. So it's something that myself and Lisa, we really take that to heart, and we try to treat every client as we want to be treated as well. So when we're looking at insurance for them, we're looking at insurance for ourselves and how we want to be protected. A lot of people do price shop. But we try to explain to them that the price is something good, but the coverage is better. So it's something that you have to learn to, or they have to learn to understand that you can get a good price, but you're not really getting the coverage that you need.
So it's you got to think about quality.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. You get what you pay for, basically.
Yeah. So it sounds like you really like to help people, right? It's, mm-hmm. It sounds like a passion.
Absolutely.
Was that one of the drivers that got you into insurance to begin with?
What got me into it was a friend of mine had mentioned that to me one time about 2 years ago, and I did some research on it, and I became very interested in it, so I started looking into it, and I took the step to take the test, and I started with a small company just doing property casualty, and then the farmer's position came available to me, or the opportunity came mm-hmm. available, and that's where I started taking my life insurance and got that together.
So you've been working in insurance before you got your examinations?
I've been in the insurance industry about a year and 4 months now.
Okay, okay.
Total.
Okay, yeah. And what were you doing before that?
Mortgages for 18 years.
Okay, so, yeah. Okay, so like a mortgage lender at a bank?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Yeah, I remember, I used to work in banking, so yeah. I remember having to give my mortgage rep a call anytime somebody came in.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. So what is it like to run your own business? Like, what's the day-to-day like?
It's for me, it's very rewarding, but it's not something that I'm taking very lightly, because I have a lot of responsibilities on myself and for Lisa, because working for someone else, the business was being fed to me.
Right.
Here, I have to go out and research and get my clientele, my referral sources, the mm-hmm. realtors, the mortgage lenders that I used mm-hmm. to work with that were colleagues of mine, because that phone won't ring unless I go out there. Mm-hmm. So I have to make the phone ring. And that way, in turn, like, I have Lisa, my agent that works for me. She's a responsibility of mine. I have to be sure that I can afford to pay her and everything else. So for me, it's a big responsibility. I'm accepting the challenge. And I think with June's help at the incubator, it's really going to help us get to where we need to be, the next level.
Mm-hmm. Oh, that's really cool. Location. And Lisa has all the same licensing?
It's a requirement. Yes, it's a requirement.
And have you been working with her since the start of your business, or have you been working with her before that?
She worked with me at the previous company I worked at.
Okay.
And then as I came on here, I brought her aboard.
Oh, cool.
Shortly after I was given the franchise, basically. Mm-hmm.
Cool. So it's just a lot of work all the time, right? It's like you never stop.
It is. And the thing about it is very rewarding, because as I said earlier, we look to help everybody. And the thing about treating people as you want to be treated is something that Lisa and I really take to heart. And we want to treat everybody the same, fairly, and make sure that we're given the best opportunity to get the best insurance possible, and not undermine anybody and give them something that it's not worth
right.
what they should be getting.
I totally understand that.
At the end of the day, it's all about protection for them.
Mm-hmm. I think that goes a long way to understand that, like, you view it like you're selling it for yourself. And I used mm-hmm. to treat banking the same way. You know, you could try to sell people credit cards with exorbitant interest rates, but mm-hmm. at the end of the day, like, if they didn't need it, why would you try to sell it to them? Like, absolutely. If they don't need it, then they don't need it. And, like, you have to understand the things that they do need to be able to provide. So what's, like, some of the takeaways you have for other business owners?
I would tell somebody else to get into something that you feel passionate about, something that you enjoy doing. I did mortgages for 18 years, and I was really passionate about it. But for me, it was time to move on to something else, and insurance became that. And as I said, it's being able to provide something that they really need and being able to explain it properly to them. And that's one thing that we found in this area, that people buy an insurance, but they have no clue what they're buying. They don't know what their coverage mm-hmm. is. And then when something happens, they call you and they're not covered for what happened. So helping somebody understand what they're buying, what they're paying for, and then letting them know what their coverage is, to me, is really fulfilling. I feel like if I'm helping my family out that way. You know, in a sense, it's my family that I'm helping.
I think that's really important, too. Do you find that it could be, like, a language barrier causing, like, the misinsurance, or do you think it's just, like, people not being well enough informed?
It's a little bit of both. It's a little bit of both. A lot of times, like I said, people are just shopping price.
Shopping price, and they don't look at the coverage, like you were saying.
They don't care about the coverage. They just want the state minimum that's there, and that's it.
Mm-hmm. And... okay, so they just want to buy the minimum. They don't mm-hmm. really want to pay for it. They're not informed enough.
Correct.
So what are some of your steps that you take to better inform? Now, you work at the Jump Start Incubator, too, mm-hmm. so I could see, you know, from my perspective, I don't know anything about insurance, mm-hmm. right? Okay. So what are some of the things that you find that other clients need?
What we do is when we're quoting a policy, we request to see their current declaration page.
Okay.
The declaration page provides us with the information of what the coverage is that they currently have. By reviewing that with them, we offer at times or all the time to do a free analysis or review of their current coverage. No obligation. Just come in and we'll review it with you and explain exactly what you do have. Mm-hmm. And if it's something that you feel it's not ample, or I'll explain to you that if it is or not, then we move forward and give them a quote and let them know where they would be with us. So the first step for us is just explain their current coverage and let them know what can be better on what they currently have, what they're paying for.
And it's free. So it's like,
absolutely,
it's their loss of not for mm-hmm. if they don't want to do mm-hmm. it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And it's only going to help them become better educated for when they have, if they so desire to make a change in the future.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm.
Do you advertise through any sort of means? Like,
right now, we're doing marketing, local marketing with media and things of that nature.
Okay.
We're starting to get involved with other groups in the area that June has been on. Introducing us to. So right now, that's where we're at right now. We haven't done any print or any type of advertising like that, no.
Okay.
Along with the idea of being with Farmers Insurance, mm-hmm. you mm-hmm. are also getting the advantage of a brand recognition.
Correct.
And
yes.
obviously, they're doing mm-hmm. national mm-hmm. advertising, which mm-hmm. is part of the benefit, too.
Yeah. A lot of our, also we do is with everybody that we write a policy with, we request three referrals from them.
Okay.
So we're getting a lot of referral business as well,
that's
not just
great.
From the marketing. So the referrals are for us, I think, more important than getting something from marketing, because it's coming from someone that actually trusted us
mm-hmm.
to and trusting us by giving us their referral, their family members or friends.
Don't you think that that's part of the culture in this area mm-hmm. also, word of mouth and
absolutely.
Having that connection to family or friends and knowing someone?
Absolutely. We've quoted policies for one person and we've had 6, 7, 8 of their family members,
mm-hmm.
you know, different households that are coming mm-hmm. to us just because of that one person that we took care of and took the time to explain to them what their insurance needs are, and just how we interact with them. You know, we make them feel at home when they come in.
So. Make them feel like a human, right? Mm-hmm. It's like you give them the element that they're a person and that you're part of the family. And testimonial word of mouth is probably one of the most powerful forms of advertisement.
Right. Absolutely.
Right.
Absolutely.
Especially when you're regional too. Like you're not you're not looking to get people from all over the country. You're a regional insurance agent. Mm-hmm. So word of mouth in the area just adds to your authority.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. And it's been helping us a lot.
Mm-hmm. Awesome.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Awesome. Thank you.
And I think insurance is a complicated issue.
I think
so. Having an agent, somebody that will sit down and explain it, is so much
important.
So important.
Especially, I could see you adding so much value to the Jumpstart Incubator just by being able to answer the questions that people have when they come up.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So, how does one become eligible to join?
To join the incubator. So it starts with a conversation with me because seriously, I need to have some idea that you have enough of a, you've thought it through enough that it makes sense to come into the incubator. We need to have businesses that really want to move forward. And the other thing is we ask for the potential clients to put together a little bit of information about their business or what their thought of their business is, and then we review that, and then you know, from there we decide that we're moving forward.
So they have to get a business plan to you, basically.
Yeah,
right?
And it doesn't have to be a whole business plan, just like in the but it needs to at least be an outline of something. A lot of people get scared when they hear the idea of a business plan because it seems overwhelming.
Like daunting.
Exactly. Yeah. And we work with them to help them to develop that business plan if that's one of the things that they need. But we want to see that there's at least an outline, a thought process of what it is that their business plan is going to be.
Plan has. Okay. So you don't have to be a client of the SBDC?
No. Not, okay. Well, and at some point, that becomes something that, you know, we work so well with the SBDC. We have resources that we share that make it very effective for the clients. And the SBDC consultants know what my skills are. I know what theirs are. So we just go back and forth. It works very well together. And I think that's one of the benefits of being in the incubator in general, is that we have access to resources beyond just me, and it helps, you know, and it just depends what the clients need. So in Jaime's case, you know, getting connected with some of the other organizations in Reading and the surrounding area makes a lot of sense, and so that's what we're spending a little bit of time on. In other places, in other situations, it might be something a little different that we need to work on.
And that's the beauty of it. It's like it's so well-rounded to cater to a whole bunch of different industries.
Right, and we try to be individual. So I work with each company on a one-on-one rather than going to a class, which is nothing wrong with that. That's helpful too. But sometimes you want to ask questions just about your business.
Yes. Yep. Like without everybody else seeing.
Exactly.
Right? It's like some things you do want to be private.
Exactly. Exactly.
Okay. Awesome. Thank you so much, June and Jaime, for coming out today. If you guys don't know, Anthony's Barbers in Wyomissing is having their grand opening from 11 to 3 tomorrow. And don't miss out on some of our classes, like Discovering What Works in Social Media. Our next available class is on September 29th. I want to thank again June and Jaime for coming out, and BCTV for hosting us today. Thank you very much. Thank you.